Thank you very much for introduction. Thank you for giving an opportunity to me to present this lecture. And I hope you will be able to see my presentation on screens. Can you see it now? Yes, okay, very good. Well, again, thanks to everyone for joining. I'm going to spend next 40-45 minutes talking about this new, relatively new, almost 10-year-old, but very exciting family of materials. And really the true exploration worldwide started just a couple of years ago. So the name of the lecture came actually from an editorial that my former postdoc and now professor at Ayupui Babak Anasuri and myself published in ACS Nano. This is actually a very good journal. I'm serving as one of associate editors, and I strongly recommend consider publishing papers there and submitting papers to us here. So why are MXINT on the rise? I will tell you in a few minutes, but first let me tell you where I come from. I work at Drexel University in Philadelphia, in Pennsylvania. This is like about 2 hours from Washington, D.C., 2 hours from New York City, 1 hour from Atlantic City, Atlantic Ocean, to give you an idea where we're located. And this used to be a technical university. You may be able to read Drexel Institute, founded about 125 years ago. And for people who have not heard name of Drexel, this is really a person who created the Wall Street. This is a person who was funding people like Andrew Carnegie, John Rockefeller, together with JP Morgan. He created the modern banking system, convincing people to take money out of their pockets, homes, and invest into future technology, building railroads, and giving people shares of those. And his family was very rich, founding many universities and colleges. His niece, actually, Catherine Drexel, was made saint by Catholic Church for founding more than 20 colleges and schools in the United States. But originally, I come from Ukraine. I am from Kyiv. I was born and raised in Kyiv. And at that time, I was working on structural ceramics, silicon nitride, silicon carbide, boron carbide. And during my postdoc at Tokens of Technology, I started to work on carbon nanomaterials, continued still to work on carbides, nitrides, and borides. And after moving to the United States, University of Illinois, Chicago in 96, I was pretty much immersed into nanomaterials, especially carbon nanomaterials. But 10 years ago, while already at Drexel University, I kind of came back to the topic of carbides, nitrides, but at a different scale, two-dimensional scale, nanoscale, when we started to work on MXINTs here. So, and really the beauty of nanotechnology is that we can create materials which don't exist in nature, which could not be predicted by conventional equilibrium thermodynamics to exist at all. But we can take atoms, molecules, and we can build many new materials, as we discuss in this article with our host and seminar series organizer, Professor Gudilin here. And really, attention to 2D material started from graphene, thanks to Andrew Geim and Kostya Novoselov, who discovered interesting new physics in graphene. It really attracted attention to both old material, traditional metal dichalcogenides, molydisulfide was actually separated in single sheets even before graphene, or oxides, layered double hydroxides, clays, but also led to discovery of materials which were never known, expected to exist in 2D state, like black phosphorus, or two-dimensional metal organic frameworks, and also MXINTs. But why 2D? Why is such an interest here? One of the reasons is that we can get a very large variety of electronic properties. Secondly, metals, semiconductors, insulators. But actually, there have not been really good metals among those materials. They atomically thin, optically transparent, mechanically flexible. If we're talking about the future electronics, wearable, flexible, Internet of Things, those are materials we need to build the future world here. And also they have high specific surface area, giving opportunity, for example, do catalysis or store energy by surface redox reactions. Moreover, there are many of them and many more predicted, thousands are predicted to exist. Many have been already made, hundreds. And we can pile them up like building blocks, like a bricks in a wall, combining materials of different properties, as we actually suggested in this article with Professor Pomerantseva, also a graduate of the department that organizes a series here. When we can take properties of different materials, combine them together, and build really new type of metamaterials or artificial materials, or people in nanoscience call them heterostructures, to get new properties. So what do carbides and nitrides of transition metals bring to this world of 2D materials, where already thousands of people are working on graphene, boron nitride, metal dichalcogenides, black phosphorus, and other materials here. Maxines are actually atomically thin structure, few atoms thin, sub-nanometer, typically just like other 2D materials. They have one interesting feature. Most of them are true metals with a high density of state at the Fermi level, with a high concentration of carriers. Something graphene and others don't have. This actually golden spheres showing transition metal atoms. Black dots in the middle show carbons, nitrogens, and I'm showing these materials OH terminated here. And this is another very important property of these materials. They are metals, but on the surface, as soon as you expose them to environment, they acquire oxygen, OH, or other can be fluorine, chlorine, depending on the synthesis method termination. So you can look at them as metallically conducting clays, or graphene and graphene oxide at the same time combining the best properties of both. Make it nicer. They come actually in three different flavors. We call them 2-1, 3-2, 4-3 structure. It seems to mean two layers, three layers, four layers of transition metal. And the first one discovered was titanium 3C2. This is the one that Michael Nagib, PhD student working with Professor Michel Barzum in our department and myself produced. But Michael already during his PhD study showed that it's possible to make all three types of structures. Moreover, it's possible to make solid solution on M side, transition metal side, also solid solution on X side, carbon nitride. So basically, we have a very, very large family of materials. And in this family of materials, we can also change the surface chemistry. And unlike in graphene, when we change the surface chemistry, we not necessarily kill conductivity or modify properties, because electrons of transition metal in the middle layer still can provide conductivity. While in graphene, when we make, for example, graphene oxide, we drop conductivity by several orders of magnitude, pretty much killing the conductance here. So this is the first paper reporting on synthesis of titanium 3C2 carbide, which opened the era of Maxine. The field started to progress quickly, several years after. The initial growth was very slow, but now we have M2X structure with single metal carbides. For example, like titanium 2C or titanium 3C2 or niobium 4C3. But we also, as I also mentioned, can make solid solution maxines, where we can pretty much in any combination combined transition metals or carbon nitrogen in the middle. So we basically have an unlimited number of compositional opportunities to select from. Moreover, in the recent years, our group and others have been pushing limits of technology further. We learn how to make materials with the outer layer made of one transition metal, for example, moly, another middle layer made of another metal like titanium. So we get something like this atomic sandwiches, where electronic properties largely will be controlled by the middle layer, while surface chemistry, chemical properties, electrochemical properties, catalytic properties will be largely controlled by the outer layer. And a group at Nichiropeng University pushed it even further, showing it's possible to make other double transition metal maxins where there are single atomic columns of one element, two atomic columns, other element. If you etch away, for example, this element, yttrium or scandium, making monatomic column, you will end up with other divalency maxin, with kind of a grooves on the surface. And we can go on, and it's definitely not the limit here. You can read our book published last year for more details here, but just as recently as January this year, we published another paper, adding the fourth column to this row, showing that it's possible to make maxin with five layers of transition metals. And we demonstrate an example of moly 4 vanadium C4 maxin phase here. And I'm sure this table will continue, will grow further here. Now, we have this huge variety of materials, at least 100 stoichiometric compounds that we know already now possible, made in 2D structures, carbides, nitrides. I'm sure many more can be made. You can think of borides organized in the same way, others here. But we have another variable. We still have a surface chemistry. What you see here is the density of state for titanium 2C maxin, one of the thinnest structures can be produced here. And as you can see, there is a high density of state at the Fermi level. So what it means, this material is clearly metallic. And all non-terminated carbides, nitrides predicted to be metallic. But if we terminate the surface with fluorine atoms, you see the density of states that decreases. But if we terminate the entire surface with oxygen, we can open the band gap. So potentially, what does it mean? It's kind of very interesting situation. We have metals where we can either chemically or actually reversibly electrochemically tune the density of state at the Fermi level. So they're not boring, unlike conventional metals, where you have metallic structure and you have it here. You can open it here and you can actually cycle potentially back and forth. And there have been a number of maxins predicted that would have pretty wide band gaps. Those are actually like chromium 2C, scandium 2C are still to be really obtained in a pure state here. But if I just summarize properties we already know and already experimentally demonstrated on the materials. One first thing we see is that maxin, for example, titanium 3C2 have very high electronic conductivity. Currently, we get films, and those not single flakes. Those are films with multiple flakes, with contact between the layers, with poor electronic transport out of plane like you want to dematerialize, with 20,000 Siemens per centimeter conductivity right after assembly and drying. This is like an order of magnitude more you can get in reducing graphene oxide films, basically graphene papers that are used today. But they also hydrophilic. They can be dispersed in water with no solvents, no additives, no nothing. They're also strong and stiff. Theoretical properties titanium 3C2, about 30 GPa modulus, 300, 500 modulus, up to 30 GPa strands already obtained on single flakes here. They're transparent. Moreover, they come in every color possible. They can be dispersed, processed entirely from aqueous solutions, naturally can be printed. Also, they absorbed electromagnetic waves in a very different wavelength ranges. Visible, UV invisible, to very far into long radio waves here. And What is also interesting, what I'm going to do today, I'm going to talk largely about electrochemical applications of those materials here. Their surface are transition metal. It looks like a transition metal oxide. What does it mean? That you can reversibly change the oxidation state and store energy by doing this here. And finally, again, going back to what I mentioned here, we have huge number of materials to select from. So there is plenty of room for people who are interested in exploring this family of materials. But another aspect, everything we know about 2D materials, we can apply to Maxim. You see, here is single about like a 20 microns. I don't think you can see a scale bar very clearly. It's probably about 20 micron in length flake of Maxim. Single air flakes suspended on aluminum oxide membrane. This is another flake of tantalum carbide Maxim, where you can see there is a second layer actually in registry with the first layer. And whenever you take selected area electron diffraction of Maxim flakes, you will see this perfect, nice patterns, because those are all single crystal flakes. And you can assemble them into films, fibers, three-dimensional structures. You can do whatever else we learned how to do with graphene or other 2D materials here. But really, what they have bringing, in addition to flexibility, strength, transparency, is largely conductivity. There are many applications where people start already exploring Maxims, where in the past either metal nanoparticles used, and we really don't have metals working well in a two-dimensional state here, or where graphene was used or nanotubes, but could not provide sufficient conductivity. And that, I think, is very important. But what is also very important? You read about discovery of new nanomaterials very frequently. Borophene was predicted, produced, grown on silver. Gallium nitride was produced on a silicon wafer hidden under a layer of graphene. And the both are still staying there. We can make this material in large quantities. From day one, we really were making grams of Maxim. Now we have a reactor designed for us by a materials research center in Kyiv. Ukraine manufactured a number of other groups actually have similar reactors already. When we can make 50 to 100 grams of material per batch in a single batch of material. If you talk about monolayer films, you can cover huge area. You talk about, for example, electromagnetic shielding coating for thousands of iPhones from a single batch produced in the lab. So it's a real material, it's scalable material, and there are very few actually nanomaterials in general and D materials in particular that can be made scalable here. And also the beauty is that if you look at this zeta potential values as a function of pH for titanium 3C2 Maxim, you will see at neutral pH, there is actually very high surface charge. So these flakes form stable colloidal solutions in a pretty wide range of pH. And actually some of them can go to minus 80 millivolt values. There are strong Lewis acids. And what it means that we can work with colloidal solutions. We can actually process these materials from very dilute solutions like you can see here, or very thick clay-like solution, which is simply liquid crystalline states of those materials here. And the process is very simple. I hope you will be able to see the movie. This is one of my students, Christine Hatter, holding a 1 liter bottle, another student in filling a spray gun, which we bought for $20 from Home Depot. This is a hardware store in America. And my former student, Mohammed and Babaka Nasuri, coating it. So it's a cheap nanotechnology. It's a simple and easy nanotechnology. You don't really need to have a $1 million piece of equipment. You don't need to build $1 billion foundries to produce devices using solution processable materials. And that's why I believe there is really bright future for 2D materials in general, solution processable materials particular. And you see, for example, Drexel University logo, which has been spray coated on a transparent film that one of my former students Kathleen Maleski is holding here. Moreover, these films have actually very interesting properties here. I want to just jump back and tell that depending on composition, how you dry, you get conductivity right away after spraying 10,000 Siemens per centimeter. We can go up to 20,000 nowadays. And this film actually, you see, this is like a paper sheet sized sprayed film. You see these wrinkles. It's a freestanding. You can take it, you can make a paper plane, you can work with it, you can cut it with scissors. So you can make actually large area structures here. And we keep pushing properties. This paper was published just earlier this week, 2 days ago on Monday, appeared online in Advanced Materials. This is work with our collaborators from Deakin University from Australia. And you see, this is a different process. Again, very simple. Doctor blade process was produced to make, for example, this like a meter and a half long, 15 centimeter, I believe, wide film. And this film is very strong. It actually gives you strength of 570 MPa. Aluminum foil, for example, has strengths between 50 and 700 megapascal. Actually, foil probably less than 700 ever here. So basically, it's at least as strong as very good quality aluminum foil. But and it has 15,000 Siemens per centimeter conductivity. And again, you just coat liquid crystal solution, dry the film, and you have this strong, highly conducting film. Moreover, I don't have time to talk about today, but 1 micron film shows electromagnetic interference shielding effectiveness of 50 decibels, sufficient to protect any device better than 10 micron metal films here. So there are very interesting properties. And of course, mechanical properties are based on high strengths of individual flakes. And we work with Alex Senitsky, another alumnus of Moscow State University, to look at properties of single layer, double layer flakes. And what basically we find that they are extremely strong. We get about 30 gigapascal strength. Actually, titanium 3C2 is not the strongest one. Niobium 4C3 is even stronger. We published another paper with Alex Sinitsky and his group recently here. But if you take solution processable materials, they are actually stronger than reducing graphene oxide or graphene oxide, even though a single flake of graphene or boron nitride separated from a perfect crystal will give you high values. And you can process many other ways. You can make simply inks by dissolving maxine in water and print it and get printable pictures. And again, you can get them in all possible colors. So conducting patterns of any colors here. And color is not just the beauty. Color simply means that these materials have high optical absorbance at various wavelengths. And as you can see, this picture showing UV's spectra of maxines, there are these absorption peaks, plasmon resonance peaks, of different maxine compositions that come at different positions. Some of them actually go into infrared range. So what does it mean that we can select materials which will have different plasmonic colors? Moreover, by applying just 1 volt voltage in a solution, we can shift the color. We have changed, we can shift actually up to 150 nanometer per volt applied the spectrum. As a result, we can make, for example, electrochromic materials. I know there is work already coming from Moscow State University reporting on use of maxine titanium 3C2 with titania, with tunable work function in solar cells. So potentially we can make flexible coatings to replace ITO for a variety of optical optoelectronic devices. They're used in femtosecond, random lasers, plasmonic, photodetectors. Number of optical applications is increasing. But I really don't have time to talk about all the application of maxines. Even Eugene promised you miracles and promised that I will tell you about everything. I can. If you agree to stay till tomorrow morning, I will put a few more slides and will entertain you talking about biomedical, optical, electronic, and other applications of MagSeeds. But since I would like to finish within about 45 minutes, I'm going to talk about just one of the applications. Application in energy storage, moreover, application in electrochemical capacitors. I know that Keith Stevenson was presenting a lecture in this series about a week ago, and Eugene already showed a plot that he used from this paper published in 2008. We actually have an updated version which Nature Materials asked us to prepare, and this is an updated plot with up-to-date values of properties. We call it a Ragone plot, which shows specific power versus specific energy. If you consider, for example, a car battery, specific energy shows you how far you can go in a single charge. Specific power shows you how well you can accelerate, how quickly you can charge your battery. And today, it takes an hour, hours to charge lithium-ion batteries. Elon Musk promised batteries, Tesla batteries, that can be charged within minutes. So how can we get from where we are right now for lithium-ion batteries with the same or higher energy density and achieve the same level of power density we have in MagSeeds? Oh, sorry, we have an double layer capacitors, current electrochemical capacitors. The only way to do it here is to actually avoid what makes charging slow. This is diffusion, slow growth of lithium. And for double layer capacitors, we need to find a mechanism that will allow us to store more energy, redox mechanism here. So battery community is moving in this direction by nanostructuring. This is actually our also recent paper published just in November last year with Katya Pomerantseva, graduate of Moscow State University, showing that really nanomaterials can bring what is needed to achieve high power. Because if you look, for example, like a Massin flake, imagine here, we have a material which has high electronic conductivity. What does it mean, high power in general, when you charge a battery? You need to run a high current through your battery or any energy storage device. You can only have high current when you have high electronic conductivity. So what it means that to make really quickly charging high power devices, we need battery materials, energy storage materials with high electronic conductivity. Oxides used today cannot do it. Carbons can do it to a certain extent, but titanium 32 has actually a conductivity about three orders of magnitude higher compared to activated carbon used today in double layer capacitance, which are considered to be the highest power energy storage devices. But we also need redox, and we need to have atoms available to redox reactions. But 2D material is entire material at the surface, so there is no solid state diffusion. So if you organize a proper structure, you can actually store energy without any kind of a diffusional processes or phase transformation. And this is what the community, it's not only our work reference to a variety of different activities, uses to develop new materials and bring materials like MagSeeds that have this combination of electronic conductivity and reversible redox processes without phase transformations, which also limit lifetime here, into the picture. And as you can see from this list, people have already been exploring MagSeeds in a variety of electrochemical applications, pretty much all possible kinds of batteries and supercapacitors. I'm only going to talk today about electrochemical capacitors. First, you learned a lot about batteries from Keith Stevenson, who is one of the leading experts in the field, but also because this is where we started to use MagSeeds initially, and actually very first work on demonstrating potential of MagSeeds electrochemical capacitors was done by Maria Lukatskaya, my former PhD student, and I will show you some of her work. But first, for people who may be less familiar with the subject, let us talk a little bit about mechanism of storage. So typically in the batteries, you have bulk storage, like insertion intercalation of lithium into graphite electrodes, or lithium iron phosphate, or cobaltate, nickelate, and other similar structures. So this is a process controlled by diffusion. It's bulk. It allows us to store significant amount of energy, but relatively slowly. Phase transformation, expansion lead again to decrease of lifetime. There is also another mechanism of storage, which is called double layer capacitors. In Russia, those devices were called ionisters. In the past, they also called supercapacitor or ultracapacitors, because they store energy like electrolytic capacitors to a certain extent on the interface between a conducting material and electrolyte. But why super or ultracapacitors? Because they store orders of magnitude more, because people use materials with high specific surface area. For several decades, activated carbon was the material of choice. But now we do have better materials, more conducting, as I mentioned, but also materials capable of surface redox reaction, basically taking energy that can be stored by transferring electrons instead of just double layer electrostatic charge, but doing it on the surface. And this is something which we call pseudo-capacitance, when we have a redox process accompanying double layer storage of ions here. So we want to be in that range when use faradic process, but at the same time we use surface storage. And this is what we are trying to do with Maxins, which actually look like almost like a perfect material for the purpose, because on the surface we have oxide, hydroxide-like structure. We have transition metal covered by oxygen or H groups. And these are materials that have been used as pseudocapacitors, ruthenium oxide, titanium oxide, manganese oxide for a long time. But most of them, except maybe ruthenium oxide, which is more conducting, suffer from poor conductivity. And here we have a layer of transition metal in the middle that can transport electrons. Moreover, when you assemble these hydrophilic layers right away from solution, you will get one, two, or three layers of water trapped between these layers. Until you dry them, you will have always open structure. If you get ions between the layers, depending on type of ions, cosmotropic, chaotropic ions, they will either bring more water, bringing partially salvation shell with them, or they actually can push water out like cesium or tetraethylammonium ions. But they will all, cations will all spontaneously even intercalate between Maxin sheets. They also will behave differently. Some of them, lithium, sodium, for example, will stick to the surface, strongly interacting with the surface. Some of them, like cesium or magnesium, will stay in between in a salvated shell. And we learn how to use them, how to benefit from charge they can bring into the material here. And this is actually, I'm showing you work done by Maria. The first paper was published in 2013, showing capacity of Maxin. And what we found that if you take sulfate, for example, or perchlorate salts of lithium, most cases you get a rectangular cyclical tomograms, which is typical for double layer capacitors. But if we take protic electrolyte like sulfuric acid, we get this not only double layer envelope, but we also get this redox peak, very, very broad, very symmetric, actually electrochemically reversible at low rates peak. But which shows clearly there is a redox which increases significantly volumetric capacitance of these materials. Moreover, this is again work published by Maria at the end of your PhD study, showing that we can push performance of this material really to the limit in all aspects. For example, you can see the double layer capacitance virtually doesn't change, and very high charge can still be stored at rates going up to 100 volts per second, not millivolts. So entire device can be charged within 10 milliseconds. And there is actually just 20-30% decrease in capacitance when it goes to 100 volts per second, and we can push even 200 volts per second. So we really, what is important fundamental observation from this? We're not really limited by the rate of redox processes for high rate storage. We're limited by simply transporting ions or electron to the system. If we have a highly conducting material with no barrier for transport of ions, we can work at almost any rate. But for example, if we increase the thickness of the film, we go down in performance simply because now ionic transport become a challenge. Still, we have volumetric capacitance value, roughly an order of magnitude above what we can reach in carbon double layer capacitors here, with very good conductivity of these materials, as a Nyquist plot shown being key reasons here. And we looked into the mechanism and showed that actually reversible reduction and oxidation of titanium in the surface layer of transition metal is the mechanism by which energy is stored. We cycle it. In this case, it was done on a synchrotron line in definitely non-optimum configuration. The change in oxidation state is fairly small. For 0.7 volt, we get something like a 1/10 of electron only transport here. But definitely, we can do much better. And we also know from in situ studies conducted at Jilin University with our colleagues later, that what we basically have, we get change between oxygen and OH-terminated maxim. And this change in the sea lattice parameter, it seems to be large in this plot, but it's in fact half an angstrom only change happening, is exactly corresponding to increase of the bond length as we go from oxygen-terminated to OH-terminated surface. So we do have this mechanism in aqueous systems, but aqueous systems are nice for rate, nice for achieving easy storage, quick storage with inexpensive electrolytes. But we cannot store that much energy because energy stored in a supercapacitor is proportional to voltage square. So when we have aqueous electrolyte with limited voltage window, we are also limited in total amount energy because it's C V square. So most devices currently use organic electrolytes. And we tried in our initial studies to use acetonitrile based electrolytes with very modest results. But more recently, my postdoctoral associate, Shuhan Guang, started to look at not only specific ions, but also what is the effect of solvent. I showed to you before in aqueous system how different behaviors are observed for different ions when we salt them in water, intercalate. Some go with water, some go without water, some bring additional water molecules here. And one important lesson to learn when people develop new materials here is that new materials for electrochemical energy storage may not necessarily operate well with traditional electrolyte, which, for example, were developed for double-layer capacitors like carbon capacitors, tetraethyl ammonium, tetrafluoroboride, and acetonitrile. When she studied several different solvents, she observed a very interesting thing. Actually, the lowest capacitance value were observed in acetonitrile-based electrolyte. In this case, it was lithium salt used here. DMSO, dimethyl sulfoxide, which actually was an all-time used as electrolyte solvent in batteries also here, gave somewhat better performance. But the best performance was achieved using propylene carbonate electrolyte, the largest area under cyclic voltammogram. And actually propylene carbonate has about an order of magnitude lower conductivity, ionic conductivity electrolyte, compared to acetate nitrile. It is totally anti-intuitive. But this material not only gave the highest capacitance, but also when we cycle it, there is no change in the lattice parameter. Moreover, the lattice parameter is the smallest. This spacing for this material is only 11 angstrom. So the very thin layer of something between the layers. There are some variations with charge and discharge in acetate nitrile. And there are wide fluctuation of space between the layers. So basically, Maxine is brazing when we intercalate same lithium ions, but from DMSO solvent electrolyte. What we found is that there are very different mechanisms of intercalation. In case of PC, giving us this very stable performance, very high capacity or capacitance, we get only lithium ions. Lithium is completely dissolved and goes between the layers. In case of acetate nitrile, we get both lithium and acetate nitrile. Moreover, lithium goes to the surface of Maxine, and acetate nitrile forms a layer of solvent molecules between the layers of conducting Maxine. So it basically like insulates layers, decreasing capacitance. In case of DMSO, lithium is everywhere. Lithium is at the surface. Lithium is the solvent in the middle. So we have fast charge-discharge, good ion transport, but we had large expansion contraction. We got like a 19 angstrom instead of 11 displacing in this material thing here. So lesson learned from this is we need to not only select from materials, from Maxines, but also match them to specific electrolytes if we want to beat the currently used materials and battery and supercapacitor systems. Moreover, I've been giving you all example of energy storage on example of titanium 3C2. But DFT calculations conducted by our colleagues within the Energy Frontier Research Center, Dean Jiang from UC Riverside and the team, showed actually that if you talk about, say, protic electrolyte, titanium 3C2 is very far from the best. The best materials are here in this red area. For example, zirconium nitrides. We can already now make titanium nitride. We can make niobium zirconium carbides. So we potentially have many materials that can give us much more efficient energy storage. And we also learn how to make flexible devices, how to make printable devices on silicon wafers. It's about like 100 by 100 array of interdigitated supercapacitor for AC-DC conversion. We can also make fibers or coating the fibers in fabric and knit devices, make some smart textiles. Moreover, Maxine can provide not only embedded energy storage, this fabric is washable. Tens of cycles of washing machine cycles, this material can stay conductive here. And we can make them also transparent. For example, this is our collaboration with Valeria Nicolosi group at Trinity University, when you can see flexible and transparent devices, again, with extremely good capacitance compared to conducting polymers, nanotubes, and graphene-based devices here. And just the last example before I start moving towards the finishes, what is also important, we have materials which to a very large extent can replace also passive materials in energy storage devices. One thing that many people don't appreciate is that in many energy storage devices, about half of the cost, weight, volume are passive materials, current collectors, separators, polymer binder, which only decreases the property by being poorly conducting here. We can use Maxine sheets as binder for activated carbon and supercapacitors or for silicon in silicon battery anodes, lithium ion battery anodes here. We can use them as a current collector for oxide electrodes or for other Maxines. Moreover, majority of electrode for supercapacitor and actually batteries that we make with Maxines, they simply don't require a current collector. So if you eliminate weight and size of current collectors, you already, by doing this, win significant inefficiencies. So let me summarize some of the things that I showed to you and also expand the application. Really, these materials are still relatively new. Compared to graphene, they're certainly underexplored, especially taking into account there are thousands of people working on single carbon nanosheets, and we have an almost unlimited number of compositions in MXNs, and at least hundreds of stoichiometric structures, of more than 30 of which have been produced, and a few dozens of solid solutions. But there are already close to 1,000 institutions that publish papers on MXN from 55 countries. You can find more than 1,000 patents filed. So they're really explored worldwide. But what you also will find that two-thirds of all this work was done on a single MXN, titanium-3C2, discovered in 2011. It's a good material. It's a biocompatible. Titanium and carbon are very abundant elements, so it can potentially be produced at fairly low cost. But it doesn't mean necessarily that it has all the best properties. It definitely doesn't. So what means that it's very important to explore other materials, especially for other applications. Moreover, investigation of certain properties application of many MXNs started very recently. For example, biomedical applications for photodynamic therapy, drug delivery, dialysis, biosensors, electrodes, neural electrodes, other type of medical electrodes where they replace gold and platinum here, started just 2017 when first papers were published. There are already reviews written now. Technology transfer to industry. So this is a very exciting field. MXNs, particularly titanium-3C2, have been shown to be the best materials for electromagnetic shielding. And they can provide flexible shielding and also flexible and transparent antennas. This work that Ася Sarachova did, unfortunately, again, I simply didn't have time to incorporate it into this presentation. And they really beat at the moment every other material by very, very large margin, when we can have submicrometers and even like a tens of nanometers coating sufficient for electromagnetic shielding of majority of pretty much all electronic devices. Here, transition metal and those materials are widely explored in catalytic applications. Optical applications are just emerging. And again, Ася Sarachova was the first one to show surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy using plasmonic MXN substrate. There are lots of activities now on photodiodes, solar cells, lasers with variety of different MXNs here. Sensors, gas sensor, biosensor, electrochemical sensors, water purification, desalination membranes, electrochemical desalination, deionization, but also, of course, pressurization, gas separation. Structural, MXNs can be incorporated into ceramic and polymer matrices and also metal matrices where our work with Dmitry Talapin. I believe Dmitry actually also Moscow State graduate, correct me if I'm wrong, Eugene. We published a paper on this subject with him recently here. But of course, energy application are the largest sector, and this is one of the reasons I talked about electrochemical capacitors today. And this is again, just the beginning, obviously here. People already start talking, this is not our work, with some thrift, about creating entire electronics based simply on MXN, calling it Maxitronics field here. And I'm not going to give conclusions to you from this work. We're very much excited about this new, very quickly growing, expanding family of materials. We have such a variety of compositions, structures, properties, potential application in the very beginning of the road, with very little actually funding and attention that MXN enjoyed so far. In our lab, over the first 5 years, this work was done with virtually no support here, based on enthusiasm of excellent students, postdoc, collaborators. So there is, I think, very bright future. There are many different challenges. I will be glad to talk about them in a question and answer session, but I think I need to wrap up here. What I wanted to mention again, that all this high productivity, many papers published every year, are not the result of my individual work, me sitting in the lab all the time. Now I'm sitting quarantined at home, as you see, as probably most of you are here. Those are outstanding students and postdocs, actually over many years, who have been doing this research. You can see Asya Sarachova here. It was before Mike Shekharov, I think, joined our group. This is a summer party in our backyard last summer. But we also work with many, many people. I listed only some key collaborators in the electrochemistry field, but there are many, many other people, and I saw some faces today of our excellent collaborators listening to this talk here. Without their work, this would not be possible here. Much of the initial and current work have been funded by the US Department of Energy, also some National Science Foundation, and Murata Japan has been one of the first adopters, the first really major adopter of this technology. This is a Fortune 1000 major company, electronic company, but definitely support from many other sources. Much of electrochemistry work was done in the framework of our first center, which is the Energy Frontier Research Center with colleagues from Oak Ridge National Laboratory, number of universities here. And this is my really very last slide. If the coronavirus doesn't prevent us from having this conference, we're going to organize in August a conference celebrating 10 years of discovery. While we published first Maxine in 2011, it was really discovered in the fall, produced in the lab in the fall of 2010. And also, I already mentioned this book, which was published by Springer last year. It's available. And if you want to read more about Maxine, you can download our papers from our website. And this is my really very last slide. Thank you very much for your attention. I will be glad to answer questions.